Okay, so in this video, I'm going to be talking about PaLM2. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about the models, a series of models. I'm going to talk a little bit about how they're structured and how you can use them. And then we'll look at actually coding something from scratch that makes use of PaLM without the use of LangChain or any other framework like that. So first off, the PaLM2 series of models was officially released on May 10 at Google I/O this year. And there are a number of variations of these models. So one of the first things to understand is that there are four main sizes of the PaLM2 models. There's Gecko, which is aimed at mobile devices and running a PaLM2 model on a mobile phone, etc. There's Otter, which is a bigger model, but still a reasonably small model. There's Bison, the one that we're going to be using today. And there's Unicorn, which Google hasn't really made public so far. So it's important to understand that when we're comparing these models to other models, what are we actually comparing? When people talk about PaLM2, often they're actually talking about the Bison model that we're going to be using here. And I would say that the Bison model is probably on par or similar to something like ChatGPT 3.5 Turbo model. It's not a GPT-4 level model. The Unicorn model is obviously a lot more powerful, but that hasn't been made public, probably for a variety of reasons, including that just serving it is going to be a challenge with all of these models. So we know that PaLM2 is driving a lot of the new changes and improvements in Bard, the experiment for conversational AI from Google. And one of the main reasons for this is that PaLM2 is actually a multilingual model and that can handle over 100 different languages. Now, I talked about in the recent video about Bard that one of the things that they've done is that they've often masked out certain languages until they're very confident that they're not going to be offensive or the accuracy is not going to be bad for those models. So today, we probably haven't seen anywhere near the amount of languages that PaLM2 can actually do. PaLM2 also has a whole bunch of coding in its pre-training. So this is something where there are specialized versions of PaLM2 that actually focus much more on code. And we can look at one of those in this as well as we're going through. So on top of this, PaLM2 is actually driving, it's like the foundation large language model for Google for over 25 products. And it's their sort of go-to model at the moment, and probably until the Gemini models come along, going to be seeing this in most of the Google products. There are also some very specialized versions of the PaLM models. So MedPaLM2 is one that's trained specifically for medical uses and a whole bunch of different things like that. While I'm not going to go into depth with that, it's pretty amazing that this model is able to get expert level on a number of sort of US medical licensing exams. And speaking to some people inside Google, they've been so impressed by it. They feel like if they were sick with some sort of disease, they would probably aim to access this. I think this is definitely the future for this. On top of MedPaLM2, there's also a model called SecPaLM, which is a specialized version of PaLM2 that's aimed for security and cybersecurity uses, which to date hasn't been made public. Another use that they're using this for is a thing called Duet AI for Google Cloud. So I think you will see a lot more coming out about this in the next few weeks. But this is basically a tool that helps you with coding and helps you with being able to set up things for Google Cloud, etc. Okay, so your access on the Google Cloud platform to the PaLM models is going to be through Vertex AI. So here you can see I've basically just brought up Vertex AI. You will need a GCP account to do this. If you've never set one up before, you will get $300 credit the first time that you set it up. And you'll be able to use this to access not only the PaLM models, but also a variety of other models in Vertex AI. You can see in here, they've got a model garden with a bunch of different models, both from Google and other open source models. And the plan is, as I understand this, is to add to this over time. So it will allow you to basically use these models for a variety of different language and vision and even audio tasks going forward. So what we're interested in here is the Generative AI Studio, and we're going to be interested in language. So I'm just going to open this up. And you'll see that in here, they've got a whole bunch of things around prompting and prompting the models. They've got a whole bunch of things around chat with the models and then tuning the models as well. So I'm not going to go through the tuning of models today. We're going to look at the three different ways you can do chat and prompting in here. Okay, so the first thing to understand, you'll see these colored sort of guides here, that there are three different ways that you can use the PaLM2 models. The first would be freeform. So the idea here is that if we wanted to do something like summary, let's just open this up and we can have a look at the thing. We can see that basically all we're doing is putting in a prompt and then we can choose our model. Here we're basically choosing the text bison model and we can submit it. And it will basically then generate a response back. So in this case, we've basically asked it to make a summary. It's made a summary from this back. And this one is just straight up text in, text out, no fancy system prompt, nothing like that. Now, obviously we can set the temperature, we can set the token limit, we can set our top K, we can set our top P like this. They have safety thresholds as well. So you can pick how safe you want the model to be. Now, I know some people are very anti the whole censorship of models and stuff like that. For business cases, this often, you know, makes a lot of sense. So this is the first form of what they call a free form. So we're just not going to save that prompt. The next one we're going to come in and have a look at is the chat style of a prompt. So you can see here, we've got a context, which is very similar to how we would have the system prompt with ChatGPT or with the OpenAI models. In fact, often we would call this like the system prompt. So this basically just sets the context of here where you are a customer service representative and it's basically got some policy and stuff. And then you can basically have some examples. So you can have like in context learning examples in here. And then here you can see that the conversation is going to be user AI, etc. So whatever I type in here will just become part of the responses of the conversation. And it's going to basically feed all of this in each time as to grow our memory. So while we're still putting in just a string and getting a string out, we've now got this formatted a lot more so that we've got this context up here. We've got this. Now you'll see that they use a different model to do this. They're using the chat bison model rather than just the plain text bison model for this. All right, so the third type of prompt that we can do is actually what we call a structured prompt. So let's have a look at this classify text here. Here you'll see that we're actually setting up, we have a context like before, we're actually using the text bison model like before, but we're setting up a number of examples of sort of input text, output text, and this is a good thing for doing sort of classification or that kind of thing. And then we would basically pass in what we want for something like this, and it will generate an output. So you can think of this as like we've got our context or our system prompt up the top. We've got our in-context learning examples here, and then we've got the one that we're actually going to feed through. Again, like with all of them, we can set our temperature, we can set our token limit, we can set, you know, the other variables there. So at any point with any of these, we can basically just come up here and click view code. And so if we click view code, we can either look at the Python, the sort of raw Python code for this. We can look at getting a collab for this that we could export out, or we can get just the actual curl commands that we would send in for this. So what I'm going to do is we're going to go back and have a look at a chat example. And we're going to go through and do their company chatbot and look at going through this and exporting this out. We're going to change it up a little bit. Okay, let's jump into the code. Okay, so in this notebook, I'm going to go through three examples of code using the PaLM2 Bison models to generate output. So the first thing you need to do is install Google Cloud AI Platform, also known as Vertex AI. And then it's very important that once you've got this installed, that you restart your runtime. If you don't do that, you will get errors later on going through it. So just restart your runtime and then you'll be fine. Everything will be set up. And the next thing that you need to do is basically go through what I call the Google authentication dance. So If you're using Colab on the same email that your Google Cloud account is on, you will be able to basically authenticate so your Colab can access everything inside of Google Cloud easily. This is really going to help you a lot for running this kind of thing. Without it, you need to create a JSON file and bring that into here and authenticate that way. But doing it this way, it'll just go through the dance of asking you to allow it to access Google Cloud Platform. And then once you authorize it, it's like Colab is now hooked up to your Google Cloud Platform. Okay, so first up, we're going to look at a chat model. We're going to be using this in the style of a chat. So you need to basically set up Vertex AI for your project. So you will need to change this out to be the project, your project name on Google Colab, and you want to set the location. This is not so important, but generally you just go for US Central, US West, one of those. And then you can see here, I'm next setting up the actual model for this. So the chat model that we're going to be using is the Chat Bison 001 model. So this is their standard chat model. So this is a version of PaLM2, size being Bison. Remember, Bison is the second biggest one. And it's probably been fine-tuned for chat. That's why they're calling it a chat model in this case. We can see we've got our standard parameters. So this is what we could set before in the UI with the temperature, max output tokens, top P, top K in there. Okay, now I'm just setting up the context of the chat. So I'm using their example in here. And this is basically a sort of a company chatbot, support chatbot, that kind of thing. And so it's just got some information in here about the company that, okay, they're headquartered in Chicago, that they make clothes. We can see, you know, that the typical price is between 50 and 300. Got a bunch of things that are in there just in the context in there. So once we've got that context set up, we can now just ping it with sending a message. So you can see here when I ask it, okay, what does Symbol sell? The response back is Symbol Direct is an online direct-to-consumer footwear and apparel retailer headquartered in Chicago. So it's just getting that information from here and putting it together. So this is standard LLM chatbot kind of thing. When was the company founded? Again, getting the founded information from in there. And when we can, so each of these is basically getting this out. Now we don't realize it, but as we've been going through this, this has actually created a message history in here. So if we want to look at the message history, we can basically look at just your chat.message history. And we can see we've just got a list of messages here. So the first one is a chat message. It's come from author user. So we've got the model author and then the user author. We could assign different names if we wanted to here. But we can see that, okay, we've got the user asking this and then the bot answering this. And then the user asking this, the bot answering this back. So this is like what you would see in a LangChain conversational history kind of thing. So you would have the different messages going through. And this is done all for you in the PaLM chat API. So remember, this is the sort of difference that makes chat different just from sort of text generation kind of thing. So that's the first one to look at. Next one I thought we'd look at is using a text generation model, but this is actually the code generation model. And we're going to use a version of Bison, which is built for code here. So here we've got code generation model from pre-trained. And what I'm doing is just giving it like the standard or one of the similar kinds of things to PaL. So where I'm basically asking it to write a Python function based on this sentence. So the sentence is Arjan started with 17 apples. He gave Haruka 11 apples. Then Amrita gave Arjan 7 more apples. How many does Arjan have now? So if we think about it, we've got 17 minus 11, and then adding 7 there. So let's look at the output for this. We can see, sure enough, it basically generates 3 backticks. So this is markdown for showing us that it's going to be code and that it's going to be Python code. And then it generates the function. And you can see that in the here, it's basically got a doc string of kind of what we just said above there. And then it basically sets each of these up with a comment for each of these. So Arjan started with 17 apples, he gave Haruka 11 apples. And you can see down here, we've got start apples minus Haruka apples plus Amrita apples. And that's going to give us the right result. So this is, in fact, just an example of PAL done from scratch in the using the code generation model from PaLM2 here. Last one I thought that I would look at is using the sort of structured prompt. And I just wanted to show you that there's nothing super special about the structured prompt. It's just a nice way for perhaps people who are not used to in-context learning thinking about it when they look at the UI. If we actually look at the code here, what we're doing is hashtag generation, and we're going to ask it to generate hashtags of tweets, and then we're passing in some different tweets, and then we're giving it the hashtags in this tweet up, and then it's going to generate them out. And sure enough, this is basically the sort of in-context learning as it goes through for these. And then finally, the last one that we're going to put in is going to be this one, launching in the next video, using PaLM2 with LangChain, creating a PaLM2 conversation agent using PaLM2 with tools. And sure enough, it can generate the hashtags out for these, giving us PaLM2, LangChain, PaLM2 conversation agent, PaLM2 tools for these. So in traditional way of thinking, this is just conditional generation with this being the input. The way that they show it in their UI is as a structured thing. And really the structured part is just the in-context learning that's going on in there. So hopefully this should give you a good example of how to use PaLM2 without any need for things like LangChain or something. In the next video, I'm going to go through using it with LangChain, and we'll look at some of the things that you can do with LangChain and PaLM2 as well. As always, if you've got any questions, please put them in the comments below. If you enjoy videos like this and you want to see a bunch more, please subscribe and click like as well. And I will see you in the next video. Bye for now.